Okay, section 7, we are almost there. Here we will discuss hyperparameter tuning and some of the value of adaptive methods. Okay, so let's get to it. We've seen already when we were discussing curvature and those ideas that choosing a good step size or learning rate, as we see, can make a big difference, right? And we're sometimes constrained by the presence of different curvatures on the same objective, which leads to slowdowns, etc. At a different level, when we're monitoring the performance, let's say, of our training run by looking at a loss plot over time, so those epochs, right? Their time, how many times we've seen the whole data set. So it's always useful to be able to diagnose our choices, our hyperparameter choices, and change them. So this is an example from a very famous Stanford deep learning course. And we have a link here to the website. And this is a very nice diagnosing chart, right? It says, if your loss curves look like this, maybe your learning rate is too high, right? It's blowing up. If it flattens out at a relatively high level, your loss, as you're monitoring it along training, then you might still be high. If you're, you know, if it decreases too slow, it might be low. And, you know, generally a good rate will give you a curve of the, of this form. Of course, these are prescriptions that could be specific to some objectives, could be specific to some models and data sets. And there's a whole zoo of situations that you can find when you're trying to engineer these systems. So what if there was a better way, right? This tuning of the learning rate can take a lot of time, and then we have other hyperparameters to tune and other model decisions to make. So there's a lot of tuning. Machine learning engineers spend a lot of time tuning and trying different things. This takes time, okay? How do we adjust the learning rate, right? So to continue with these prescriptions and to help you diagnose, if you're learning too fast, you might see wild variations of your loss curve. You might see it blow up, but you might also see it go up and down dramatically. You could converge towards solutions with huge weights, positive or negative weights, or even at some point infinity or nans, as we say, not a number. Those are all signs of a very large learning rate. If you're learning too slowly, you will see that convergence takes forever, and whatever that means. But more importantly, you will see your loss curve not make much progress, or very slowly and steadily making progress. So general rule of thumb is to decrease the rate if you see those wild variations, and otherwise try increasing it. Right, so at the end, another thing is that the initial parts of training, you might need a bigger step size than a later parts of training. This is all very complicated, right? Can we automate this thing somehow? People have studied learning rate schedules in all sorts of shapes and forms. What is a schedule? It means that the step size that I'm using, or the learning rate that I'm using, eta, is a function of time. Now it's eta t on this slide, okay? And some popular schedules have this polynomial form that I'm showing here at the top. They're exponential, stepwise decays, cosine and cyclical schedules. It's a whole zoo out there. And these are all implemented on PyTorch and other libraries for deep learning. But still, there we have hyperparameters to tune. This alpha, this C here on the slide. People have always been curious about adaptive methods. And that's one reason. The other side of the story is that for all of these methods, we're using one scalar learning rate for all of the weights. Okay? And this takes us back to our poor conditioning discussion in section 4. Okay? In the context of neural networks, we often observe that different layers can produce gradients of dramatically different magnitudes. Okay? So some layers will give you a gradient that's in the, you know, whose norm is in the millions. Another one will give you a gradient whose norm is 2 or something like that. So that's also an example of poor conditioning, or a sign, let's say, of poor conditioning. One layer needs a big step size, another layer needs a small step size. How do we deal with this? There's a couple of ideas. One classic one is to clip gradients, to say that, okay, we'll use the same step size, the same learning rate, but if the gradients become too big, we will clip them, meaning that we will multiply them with a number that's smaller than 1 until they go down below a threshold. That's called gradient clipping. Another idea, which is way more common, is to use individual learning rates for the different weights or layers of your neural network. So, and this is another way to deal with poor conditioning, right? If this is the same sublevel sets I was looking at earlier, and along W1, one of my weights, I see a flat direction, and along W2, my other weight, I see a sharp direction, I can recondition this whole thing by using different learning rates for the different directions. And I can make independent choices rather than following that trade-off that we saw earlier that makes us go and that makes us choose one learning rate in between and sacrifices our speed, right? So that is the idea of adaptive methods, okay? Adaptive methods comprise two important elements, at least this family of adaptive methods. And the first one is that the learning rate adapts to our gradients, and we will see how that works in a second. And the second one is that we're using individual learning rates for each weight, okay? And that can be very beneficial, as we discussed in cases of poor conditioning. So the lineage of adaptive methods, or at least the ones that are used very much today in machine learning, can be traced back to this 2011 paper by Ducci and others. And the basic method here is called ADAGRAD, from adaptive gradient algorithm. And as we discussed, we have one learning rate for each parameter, right? For each weight. And there's a magical formula here. We will see it in a second, but this is otherwise gradient descent. I should point out the notation I'm using in these slides just to avoid overloading these round brackets, okay? So this is a vector, right? This is our gradient when we're trying to minimize objective J. This could be our empirical risk or the SGD or mini-batch version of it, right? So this is the gradient that we use. Could be full gradient or stochastic or mini-batch gradient. And this square bracket notation here is indexing, okay? Here, this is a vector, and I'm taking the ith element of the vector. Similarly here and here, okay? So we do this for each I, where I indexes the parameter that we're updating. So this is gradient descent, okay? And this is the adaptive learning rate that we use for this particular parameter. How do we compute this denominator here? We maintain a running sum of squares of gradients. So again, for the ith parameter, we will look at the ith element of the gradient. We will square it. We will raise it to the power 2. And then we will keep a running sum of those gradients over time, okay, throughout the execution of the algorithm. And then this is the sum of squares of past gradients for that particular weight, right? That's what we maintain here. So this is schedule. This gives us a schedule that decays as we go along. This method is known to perform very well on convex objectives, okay? There's some guarantees that we will not go into. Okay, so that's the basic method. What happens for non-convex methods? Aramis prop is a variant of Adagrad. It's described by Jeff Hinton in one of his lectures, and instead, in this part, instead of using a running sum of gradient squares, right, we're using a moving average. The moving average forgets. That is the main difference here. The moving average forgets at this rate, where this A, or alpha actually, is a hyperparameter, okay? And it tells us how quickly, if this value is small, it tells us that we will quickly forget the gradient squares that we have accumulated in V, right? This is particularly useful for non-convex objectives, because for non-convex objectives, it is possible for us to see parts of this loss landscape, right? This the surface of our objective be steep and then flat and then steep again, which does not happen in convex optimization. So for non-convex objective, it is useful to forget, so you can adapt to all of these changes of the landscape. And that's the novelty here of RMS prop. And then taking things one step further, in 2015, Kingma and Ba proposed ADAM, which is short for adaptive momentum, which basically takes RMS prop and adds momentum to it, and it fixes another couple of important limitations of RMS prop, let's say. So they did very clever engineering to come up with ADAM, which is currently the most popular adaptive method used in deep learning. It's extremely successful, and because it saves us so much time in tuning, okay? People still will end up using, for stable workflows, researchers in some cases still end up using SGD momentum, because in some cases it seems to give better generalization, but the value of those adaptive methods cannot be overstated. They're extremely valuable when we're developing a new system, that we get results very, very quickly.